is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. Very excited to have a return guest on the show, Kiera Dent. Hey, Kiera, how are you?
I'm so good, Gary. How are you doing?
Oh, man, just awesome. It's great to hear your voice again.
I know. It feels so long. We used to work together at Midwestern, and I see you all the time. It's like, it's been so long. How are you?
I know. I'm doing great. And here you are. You're in Dallas as we're recording this, and I'm in Scottsdale. And you are going to be together with one of my dear friends, Heidi Arndt. So how fun is that?
So fun. I'm excited. We have a big hygiene conference this weekend, and she's just fantastic. So fun to learn from the best. I feel like it always makes us better. So wow. I'm really excited. She's just amazing.
Heidi is absolutely amazing. I've had her as a guest on the show a couple times, and she is doing some wonderful things in the world of hygiene. So, hey, when you see Heidi tomorrow, give her a bear hug from me.
You bet. Absolutely. And when you see Dr. Smith at Midwestern, please return the favor to him
will
for me.
I will see him on Monday. And I'm going to share, if you don't mind me sharing with our listeners where you're headed off to. But before we do that, I'm going to introduce our topic. We're going to give the office managers some love on this podcast. How's that sound?
I feel good about it. I think office managers need love.
Office managers definitely need some love. It's an interesting universe in dentistry in that, it seems like every one of the tribes in dentistry has their own group to connect to. You know, dentists have multiple associations, of course. Assistants now, have associations that they can connect with. Our hygienists have associations. And only recently did our office managers and administrative team members have, a community to connect to. And you're about to contribute to that. The community that I'm referencing is ADOM, the American Association of Dental Office Managers. It's a wonderful group. It was founded by a good friend of mine, Heather Colicchio. In fact, I just had an opportunity to speak at their national conference in Scottsdale this past September. And you are about to do some really cool things to add to the office manager community. So we're going to talk about all things office manager on this podcast. How's that sound?
I feel great about it. I'm really excited because I think it's an area that doesn't get as much attention, especially on these podcasts. And when I talk to dentists, so dentists and office managers, like this is a world that dentists aren't totally familiar with either. And so I love to just add value in that realm as well. So I'm jazzed about it. I'm excited.
Well, hey, and I want to brag on you for just a minute, because next week, you are about to, depart on an adventure, and, you and a team is going to be heading to Tonga in the South Pacific to do some third world dentistry. How cool is that?
We are so excited because, Dental Placement Pros, which is my other company, the recruiting company that we talked about before on a podcast, my business partner and I decided we wanted it to be a for-purpose company. And so Dr. Smith with Midwestern in Tonga, he allowed us to let Dental Placement Pros become part of that. So we're able to sponsor part of it. And Dental Placement Pros has really just grown. So thanks to all the people that are helping to contribute, because now we've changed it into proceeds from every single hire actually go to, right now we're working on a scholarship for students that are going into the world of dentistry, where we actually pay for a scholarship for a student to go to dental school. And Tonga, going and doing third world dentistry, is Dental Placement Pros is also going. And it's just exciting to give back. Like that's why we work. That's why we create money, because then we're able to use that money to make it matter and to just give back to the world that we've been so blessed by. So I am excited. Dr. Smith, Tonga, all of that. It's just going to be a blast to go over there.
So I'm going to give a little bit more background for our listeners. Most of you know that on Mondays, I teach at Midwestern University School of Dental Medicine. And I teach the behavioral side of dentistry, the people side of dentistry. So I teach things like emotional intelligence, communication skills, team building skills, how to talk to patients about dentistry in a way that gets them excited about accepting recommended treatment. And it is really a passion of mine to teach. And our dean is Dr. Brad Smith. You and I have had the privilege of working with Dr. Smith for quite some time. And a number of years ago, the dental school decided that they wanted to create an environment where they could do dentistry in a place that was not served well by healthcare. And they went down and built a clinic in Tonga in the South Pacific in an island that did not have any dental care. And they built a clinic that is now twice a year. Dental students go from Midwestern to provide care in Tonga to islanders that wouldn't have access to care any other way. And so we go in November and also in May. And the clinic is actually staffed year round, but we go down every year, twice a year, with a team, you know, from the university to provide care. And there it's a whole group of people. There's dental students, there's faculty members, there's support team members that go down. And in fact, I shared with you when you and I were getting ready to record tonight, that my wife and I, Teresa and I, are going next November. So November of 2018, my wife and I are going to Tonga. We're actually going to spend 2 weeks in the clinic helping and doing wherever they need us. We're going to be down there helping. And since we're down there, we're going to then spend another week in Fiji. So we're going to work for 2 weeks. Someone's got to do it, right?
Somebody, absolutely. In 2018, you've got your goals set already, right? Priorities, Gary. That's I love right. it. Well, go do some service, hang out in the Fiji, you know.
And as you know, the 2 weeks that you'll be down there working, they work your tail off.
Absolutely. It was funny because we were supposed to just go for 1 week, and then Dr. Smith called and he said, Kiera, I don't even want to ask you because I know you're so busy, but can you do 2 weeks? And my first thought was, it's over Thanksgiving, Dr. Smith, but we're so excited because we get to stay over there. And I thought, what a cool way to spend Thanksgiving. And, you know, it's just, it's awesome. We're so excited and we are ready to work. We can't wait. So,
you know, I've had the privilege of being involved in charitable dentistry around the world. And I've always said that I'm never sure who benefits more, the people that are receiving the care or the people that are providing the care. Because it is such an amazing experience to help people that wouldn't receive care any other way. So, Kiera, I will be thinking about you these next 2 weeks. I can't wait to hear all, you know, maybe we should have you come on back after you return, get you back on the show and talk about your experiences in Tonga. Wouldn't that be fun?
That would be a lot of fun. I'd love to do that. So we got a date already.
Okay, that's a deal.
Tonga, we'll talk. Deal.
That is a deal. Well, hey, let's dive into our discussion tonight. We're going to talk about office managers. And, you know, in particular, I want to talk about some of the struggles that office managers experience because they're common. We see it all the time. Can you identify some of the struggles that you routinely see? And then maybe we can talk about how we can help office managers overcome those struggles.
Definitely. Yeah. So it's interesting because, you know, just over a year and a half ago, I was an office manager of very large offices. I had 32 employees. I had 2 locations. And, you know, this is before I started my consulting company and then partnering with Mark Costas in the Dental Success Institute. And as an office manager, I really struggled because I went from being a dental assistant and then I, you know, went to front office and then I worked at the school and I did office management as well. But I realized one of the biggest struggles was I was plunked into office management. And when you become an office manager, there's really nobody else there to help you, to guide you, to train you. You become that person and you have to learn
You're on an island. It's a bit of we talk about Tonga, a real island.
Right.
But most office managers feel like they're on an island themselves, and there's some loneliness that goes with that. I don't mean that in a personal sense, but I mean, in terms of feeling like they don't have support.
For sure. Google becomes your best friend because you're like always trying to figure out like, how do I do this or how do I do that? And I agree with the loneliness. And it's not, like you said, it's not a personal thing. It's not, you have a great team around you, but I think it's more loneliness in the sense of who do I talk to? Who do I reach out to? What group, where is support to know like what an office manager is supposed to do? And then how do I do a lot of those tasks? And yes, office managers do so much for an office that we do learn and we know. But then I remember when I transitioned into the world of being an office manager that instantly I was no longer, it wasn't even that I wasn't friends, but I wasn't friends with my coworkers anymore because I was now their leader. And so there was a complete difference. It doesn't mean you can't be friends, but there was just a different feeling. And also I went from being very much task oriented, right? Like we're given our tasks, we know what we're supposed to do, to being this person who was supposed to create, who was supposed to come up with plans and protocols and procedures. And, you know, and there was none of that. Like I love to have a checklist and be able to see my progress and check it off and know I did everything I needed to do for the day. But when you office management, there's no longer that per se checklist that you can see the progress. You're kind of in this world of you give yourself your own positive kudos. You give yourself those, you know, well, I guess this is what I'm going to do. I'll brainstorm with myself and maybe some of my teammates, but ultimately these decisions rest on my shoulders and I need to know how to do them to grow my practice.
And if I think, you know, if I can be critical for just a minute, the training or the lack of training that exists out there, you know, can be another issue as well. Many office managers, you know, have had essentially on the job training to learn, you know, their craft as an office manager. And I know you are going to be doing some things about that to provide even more resources for office managers so they can actually get some formalized training and not just feel like they're thrown to the wolves.
Absolutely. It's crazy. I mean, I've been in over 50 offices in 2017 this year. And I talk with a lot of office managers from all different styles and different backgrounds. And I'm realizing I feel like office management in front office is a lot of like the game of telephone where it gets passed down from person to person to person. And we're expected just to learn it. And sometimes it's like, well, why? Like I was just in an office today. And, you know, I mean, there's no right or wrong way to do it, which I think kind of create some of that muddy water. But this office was verifying their insurance for all the patients in restorative and none of their patients in hygiene. And I would ask them like, well, why are we not being proactive on verifying hygiene so that way we can give better treatment plans? Because what they were doing is they had all these hygiene patients and then they'd bring them back for consults when they actually could do their benefits, bring them in for restorative and then verify their insurance at that point. And it was one of those things that like, well, that's just how we've always done it. And right. So I feel like it's so traditional based and you're stuck in an office. And most office managers, you worked in maybe two or three offices. Mm-hmm. So you have like a little bit of flavor, but two or three offices when there's a plethora and we could be so much more efficient mm-hmm. if we all worked together, shared our ideas together, right? There was some resource to be able to create that community and just be more efficient. While being on our own little islands.
May I share a story related to your comment about, well, that's how we've always done it? May I share a story with you?
Absolutely.
So recently I was in an office as a coach, and one of the things I noticed was that this office was very tangled up with insurance. And the way they were handling insurance was very much a 1970s, 1980s model. Of how to do this. For example, one of the things they did is they routinely did predeterminations with the insurance
company. Which I believe are pre-denials. Let's just throw
eggs. Well, you know, we didn't even talk about this ahead of time, but I absolutely know we're on the same page on this one, Kiera.
Perfect.
But anyway, this is an office that does predeterminations on virtually every treatment. And you wouldn't be surprised. This office is transitioning to digital, but right now they're still pretty encumbered with paper. And so they keep the predeterminations and they put them in a file cabinet. And they literally had thousands of predeterminations back from the insurance companies now sitting in a file cabinet with nothing happening with these. Nothing was happening. And I sat down with the office manager and I said, tell me how you're handling, you know, insurance and in particular, tell me how you're handling predeterminations or what you and I like to call pre-denials. And she explained, she said, well, because we don't want to be wrong, we want to be able to give our patients good answers. She said, we routinely do predeterminations. And, you know, I had to use some emotional intelligence at this point, Kiera, not to, not to be too critical, of course.
Definitely. But keep them on your side.
Exactly. So I said, well, tell me a little bit about why you do this. And she said, well, just when we get a predetermination back, it now tells us exactly what the insurance company is going to do. I said, oh, okay. And I pulled the predetermination, and you know what it says at the bottom of the predetermination. It says, this is no guarantee. Yep, this exactly. is not a commitment to do anything. Now, I'm using my own facetious language. It didn't actually say this, but this was the tone. We have no agreement or no commitment to pay on anything. You've simply wasted your time. Thank you for falling into our trap.
Exactly. We don't want to pay it. We want to just delay treatment in any way we can. So.
Now, can you imagine this, Kiera? So imagine that you are shopping. And imagine that you find a dress that you like. I'll just use a silly example. May I do that?
We know where we're headed. Yes, okay. Absolutely.
So imagine that you bring the dress, to the checkout register, and the clerk says, "Oh my gosh, Kiera, you look absolutely amazing. That dress is fabulous. It suits your coloration and your hair color. And oh wow, you look amazing in this dress. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to hold it over here." And you can come on, get it in 6 or 7 or 8 weeks, maybe.
Perfect. I'm pretty sure it will still fit, still be perfect for me. And I mean, it's going to be winter and I'm buying a summer dress. It'll be perfect for me. Thank you.
I believe, you know how industries have their awards and, that people that make remarkable progress in their industry receive an award. I believe that one year, I don't know when it was probably 1976, that the insurance company got together and someone came up with this idea. Someone said, you know what? Let's make a game where we make up this thing called predeterminations and we trick the offices into thinking they have to do them. And then we delay them as long as we possibly can. And then by the time we get the predetermination back, the patient will forget about why they were even interested in the treatment. And I believe that person got the Gold Star Award from the insurance company.
They definitely did. And I mean, I'm sure doctors listening, they might not even know predeterminations or even realize we don't have to do predetermination. Office managers wait, what? We've always done them. And these are those little secrets here that we're talking about that when you're in an office, you don't know. I feel like imagine the human race and we're all just stuck in these little boxes and given the same tools, but none of us are told how to do anything with them. And so we just figure it out as creative human beings we are, but there are so many more efficient, effective ways right. in every single office. Right. And so, I mean, and to piggyback on your story, cause I love it. There was an office I was in and their billing department, and this happens all the time, Gary. So pick whichever position. I'm sure you've seen it a million times. That person leaves and all that information goes with them. And now it's like, oh no,
what are we
supposed to do now?
The entire system screeches to a screaming halt, right there. Well, when I asked the office manager in this office, I said, tell me a little bit about why you do it this way. And basically her answer was, well, that's how we've always done it. Now this story has a really happy ending because I showed her a better system for handling predeterminations. And Kiera, correct me if you feel differently, but here's my approach on predeterminations. Very, very rarely, it's a very rare occurrence. It might be 2 times a year that it might be appropriate to file predetermination. And that would only be for an unusual procedure that you simply don't have any experience on, or maybe a very unusual insurance policy that you really have no ability to guess or estimate how the insurance company might handle it. And in a typical busy practice like ours or like yours and Mark's, that might be once or twice a year. That's about it. Maybe.
I couldn't agree with you more. Yeah. It's just crazy because so many people do them, but I also think patients have learned that lingo as well. And it gets them out of the treatment because they know, just send it out. I want to know right. exactly. And it's like,
it's but there's, not hurting. Real, yes.
there's no exact, exactly. Right. So definitely no, we do not schedule based on that. And it's on purpose. We want to be as close as possible, but also I'm a firm believer to schedule based on treatment, not on insurance as well, right. and making sure the patients receive that quality care. That does not mean, don't find out your insurance benefits, help the patient as much as they can.
Right.
But also, like you said, they're there. They want to buy that dress. Let them buy it. Let's not create all the obstacles. Let's create all the ways for them to say yes.
So here we are a few months later, and this new system's been in place, and we have virtually eliminated predeterminations in this office. And the office manager, she's really a wonderful spirit. And even though she was kind of stuck in the, well, this is the way we've always done it, she was also open-minded to learning new ways. And she's come back to me twice now in the last week and said to me, Gary, I'm so glad we're not doing predeterminations anymore. I have so much more time to tackle more important topics. And
definitely.
It's a success story for sure. But, you know,
that is a great success.
Well, and certainly the whole area, the whole world of insurance is just another, you know, one of those areas that office managers often don't know where to turn for resources. Hey, but let's hit another topic related to that. And this is a little bit of a sensitive one. But I think we have to address it. And I think we have to have the courage to address it. And that is that in reality, many dentists don't know how the role of an office manager and how to guide the office manager. Would you say that's an accurate statement or am I exaggerating?
No, you're absolutely correct. And I get that question so many times from clients because they're just like, Kiera, I went to dental school and I learned how to be a dentist. I didn't learn how to be a business owner and I didn't learn how to do the front desk. I have no clue. So many dentists are literally handcuffed and paralyzed because they don't know the front desk and they get burned so much because they don't know it. They don't know what the office managers are doing. They truly don't know how to gauge it. So you are not off base whatsoever. And that's a huge reason I wanted to even give this as a resource, because not just office managers need it, but dentists as well have a place to go and ask questions and to know how to find that help.
Right, right. And you know, it, I think I love the humility, you know, when dentists, and they really can vary from every stage of their career. These could be young dentists, they could be mid-career dentists, they could be late-career dentists. And, you know, they'll say, I really don't know how to interact with an office manager, and I don't know how to provide the guidance and leadership that I need to provide so we can work functionally as a team.
For sure.
And I love the humility when that exists, because it in that humility is the open space from which to solve it, you know, and to figure out how to make
this work. Right, exactly. Well, and then the office manager in the same instances, they also have a little bit of frustration and unclear because they don't know what expectations they want, but the dentist doesn't even know what expectations to give. It's kind of like, well, I just did an example the other day in an office where I went and, you know, I brought somebody up and I dumped bread, peanut butter, and jelly in front of them. And I said, do it. Like, just go for it, do it. And, you know, they kind of look at me and I was like, how often do we do that? The dentist can say, okay, well, I want my production to be this. Now go do it. And the office manager is like, okay, well, what exactly does that mean? And, wow, you know, do you want a double decker peanut butter and jelly? Do you just want peanut butter on one side? Like, what are you
what
really
you
looking
want?
For? Exactly. But the dentist, you know, they're like, well, I don't know how to guide you, like you were saying. And so I really feel like it is that space of, if we can help clear that up for both the dentist and the office managers, create some of those resources. So then it's not that, well, what am I supposed to do? It's here, let's give you some guidance so that way you can actually feel confident and be able to create those conversations.
Right. You know, I work with an amazing office manager not far from where you are right now. This is a little bit west of you in Fort Worth, but a wonderful office, Dr. Nikki Green, and her office manager is absolutely amazing. And one of the things that she does is she does a really good job in focusing the team on growth and making growth a positive part of their culture. So the entire team now looks at the opportunity to become more productive every day as a wonderful challenge instead of, oh no, I have to work harder now.
Right.
And you know, if I can get on my soapbox for just a minute, you know, and I know you and Mark and your team addresses this or you bump into this all the time, where overhead is too high. Okay. Let's just address it. Overhead's too high. Well, and by the way, the ADA, the American Dental Association, says the average solo general dentist in 2016 had 74% overhead. 74% overhead. And in my ouch is exactly right. In my opinion, If that is happening to you, doctors, you're working way too hard for too little. You deserve better than that. I like to see overhead no higher than 60%, ideally 50%.
I agree.
It's not easy to get it there, but it's entirely possible. But when you look at overhead, we can solve it a couple different ways. One way would be to look at reducing expenses. And I believe that that is a worthy activity. We certainly don't want to waste anything. We don't want to misspend. And that's a worthy activity. But I will just declare right here, and you correct me if you know differently, Kiera, but I have yet to meet the dentist that says, I was able to create financial independence because I saved $2 on a box of gloves.
But they might think so.
Have you met that person?
You know, I unfortunately have not. But no. When I do, Gary, we will interview him.
Please do.
Or her.
I'd like to. Or her, please. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't pay attention to expenses. Please, you know, as a listener, don't misinterpret me on this. But if we could grow your practice, and I'm going to put two disclaimers out there. Same team, same hours. Same team, same hours. And just assume, just take a jump in faith and assume we could do that. And let me use a round number here. Let's use $100,000 because it makes my math easy. We're going to grow the practice $100,000 this year. Same team, same hours. Would you accept that as a model for me to carry through this example?
Definitely.
So what happens as you grow your practice $100,000? And by the way, I believe every one of our listeners, every one of you has that within you to do. And actually pretty easy.
Most definitely.
Pretty easy.
And it's easy. It's the low-lying fruit.
It's low-hanging fruit.
Very easy.
So look at this. So as you grow your practice, we have fixed and variable expenses. Your fixed expenses, as the definition would imply, stay the same. So your mortgage or your lease, facility lease, stays the same. Essentially, your payroll stays the same, even though I know payroll is essentially a variable expense because we have different hours and so on. But if we're not going to add team members, your payroll is essentially the same. Your ADA dues are the same. Your malpractice insurance is the same. Versus variable expenses, those are the expenses that will vary depending on the amount of dentistry that you do. And essentially, there's only two variable expenses in a practice, if we're doing same team, same hours. And that would be your consumable supplies, because the more dentistry you do, the more supplies you'll use. And lab, if you're using an outside lab, or if you're using CEREC, you're still going to have some supplies related to that. So can we walk through the example of what happens when you grow, Kiera? So we grow $100,000. The budget I use for consumable supplies is 6% or less. Is that consistent with what you're finding in practices?
It is. We aim for 5% on supplies.
I like yours better.
5-6. Right.
Let's use mine on this one to give a little bit of a fudge factor. Okay.
Sure.
I love your 5% though. But let's say 6% for consumable supplies. And then it's a little bit difficult to forecast lab because it depends whether we're using an outside lab or whether we're using a CAD/CAM. But if we're using an outside lab, I want that to be at or below 10%. That would be a very high expense for lab. That would assume that we're using very high quality lab labs. We're getting a quality product from our lab. And if we are a CAD/CAM practice, what do you see as the what I would call a lab expense related to CAD/CAM? Is it down to 3-4%?
Yeah, it's much less with that, definitely.
Yeah. So let's just say 10% for lab, 6% for supplies. We're at 16%. And let's go ahead, because inevitably some other expenses go up as well. And I'm not sure what it is, Kiera. I don't know if we're buying the pillowy soft toilet paper.
I like that. Charmin, right?
Charmin. Maybe it's that. But whatever
maybe
it is.
Maybe it's a smelly soap. We like the
it's
nice
the soap.
Soap.
Must be the soap.
it's the soap.
But let's just say there's another 4% to make the math really easy. So 10 for lab, 6 for consumable supplies, 4% for miscellaneous things that ride up as well. We're at 20% overhead on the top $100,000.
20%.
You keep 80%. And now that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. But now let's do it again. Let's grow another 100%, another 100,000. And now, doctors, you're going to keep 160 of the top 200,000. You may make more in the top 200,000 than you made in your first 600,000 or your first 700,000. Mm-hmm. And I know you see this all the time, Kiera, and it's so, the math wizardry is so enjoyable when it comes together like this. But it takes a team that looks at growth as a positive occurrence instead of, oh no, I just have to work harder.
Definitely. But I feel like that culture comes from the dentist and the office manager. Office managers play a huge, huge, huge role in the attitude of the team of, is growth positive or is growth negative? Is the dentist just greedy and wants to make more money? Or is this a way to benefit our entire team and our patients, right? It's all these different attitudes. And the office manager, like, this is a huge thing you just tapped into, Gary, of office managers, some of them are stuck, right? We go into these offices and their team is just a mess. And they're like, well, how do I have them not view growth as a negative? And those are like those resources of, I don't know, I guess I just figured out on my own, when mm-hmm. there are so many other resources to help with that growth mentality, with the positivity, for sure.
Well, and as you and I were prepping for our recording for this podcast, you talked about a value bomb. And I love that terminology, by the way, because it just gives me a graphic kind of image in my head. But talk about the value bomb of team building.
Oh my goodness. And value bomb, I just snagged that from another dentist. He asked me to write a chapter for his book and he said, Kiera, you have to give value bombs in it. I just think it's so funny because you're right. It's so clever. But a value bomb of team building is that I just feel like when your team is strong, your office is strong. And it comes from leaders. Mark Casas raves about the book Extreme Ownership. And, you know, where a leader owns that, they own their team. There are no bad teams. There are just bad leaders is what the book teaches, right? Like, and so it's all about leadership. And if you have a strong team and team building, really, gosh, you can do so much. And if your team is resistant, then you have those struggles. And to give an example that I just came from, this office, their back office was really struggling. They have a huge practice. There are 17 operatories. They have so many team members. It's insane. You feel like you're in but it's so personal and they're very personable with every patient. But with them, their back office was really struggling. The assistant team was just not jiving. But this office has worked so hard on team building. And some of the value bombs for you from this office is they have every Monday, they have meetings together that are growth meetings as an office where they all break out into their individual departments to see how that individual department can grow towards the office vision and model. They also do things that are just fun and in these meetings, like they just had a hula hoop contest. We just did a balloon building contest. So just fun things that create that unity, those bonds. And when you have a team culture like that, where it's very much, this office manager does not tolerate people not working together as a team. It's just, that's just not part of the culture and she will not tolerate it. And so this office, their back office was really struggling, which is so bizarre because it's anti the culture of the practice. And so we just went in and we did a massive shift of this entire office, the back office, everyone switched doctors, everyone switched rooms to get everybody on a level playing field. Now, if you have an office that does not have a strong team building office, that would have been sheer mayhem, right? Like there would have been so much resistance, angry, like attitude with the patients, attitude with the doctors. But this office, like there was, I'm not going to say that they were pleasant and super happy with it. They were definitely a little frustrated because everybody likes to be comfortable. But because this office had, you know, grasped and really taken hold of a team building office, the back office switched, they rotated, they listened to their leaders and they actually did it. And it was this incredible transformation of the entire office through one simple activity that wasn't, it didn't feel simple, but it really was. And the point of that whole story is they grew as a team. That's the value bomb that I want to drop of. If you can create cultures, look for those little opportunities, have meetings, have crystal clear communication with your team so they know. Set clear expectations. Don't assume. All those things foster so much team growth, right. Unity, and relationships for the whole team. And if you have a team that stands beside you and supports you, you have so much. It's so easy to grow a practice because right. they support you. They trust you. And it's one of those things where I feel like there are two ways that you can grow. You can grow and it can be very, very hard, or you can grow and it can be very, very easy. And literally one of the biggest factors in that is, what does your team feel and what have you done to create that culture within your team? Right. If your team supports you and they're running with you, and there's that, you will produce and you will grow so quickly and so easily. If they don't support you and they're anti and there's no team unity, it feels like you're just pulling teeth. Should we use that analogy?
Right.
It feels so hard to grow. And that's,
you're fighting it. You're constantly
really believe,
fighting it.
Well, exactly.
I want to stick with this theme of value bombs. And I just thought of something as we were talking. As you mentioned, one of Mark's favorite books is Extreme Ownership. It's subtitled How U.S. Navy SEALs Lead and Win. I literally have the book in my hand. It was on my shelf. And as you mentioned that, I grabbed it. It was written by two authors, Jocko Willink and Leif Babin. And if I'm not mistaken, I think Mark has a sponsor on his podcast, on the Dentalpreneur podcast of Audible. Is that correct?
Correct. Yes.
So I'll put a link for Mark's Audible. And I believe that new listeners get a free book. Is that right?
That's correct. Yep. One free download. And this would be a great one to download.
So I'll put that in the show notes. I'll get that information from you, Kieran. I'll put that in the show notes. So if you're listening to this and you'd like to get a free download, and given that you like to listen to podcasts, I bet you'd like to listen to audiobooks. So this is by Audible, and that's Mark's link. I'll put that in there so he gets credit for that. And you'll get a chance to listen to the book, Extreme Ownership, How U.S. Navy SEALs Lead and Win. So how's that for a bonus value bomb?
That's a bonus value bomb, because that book is so good for dentists, for office managers, for your team. I mean, if you want to get team unity, that is a book to read as a team and to discuss, and you will find a transformation in your office. I've had plenty of offices that have done that, and you start to realize that everything does fall on you as the leader. And if things are falling apart, that is a direct reflection of you and your leadership. Right. And when you can be humble and take that, you once again have massive growth, because you're humble and you're open to it and you change and your team changes.
I've had the privilege of speaking on the same program that Jocko Willink was speaking on, and I had a chance to meet him. And what an amazing resource. He's one of those speakers and leaders that you're just captivated by. It's like you just want some of that mojo, you know?
Absolutely.
I bet.
I can only imagine. You were there. That's awesome.
It is amazing. So, hey, we have another value bomb for our listeners. Talk a little bit about the webinar that you're putting together and the resources that you're putting together.
For sure. Thank you. Yeah. So I think that this comes, we can do a good plug for Midwestern. That's a value bomb. If anyone wants to just experience something great, go say hi to Midwestern University in Phoenix, Arizona, and you will just see an amazing culture that's just fostered there.
But and let's actually pause on that for just a minute. Many of our listeners are young dentists. Many are in dental school, young dentists, and we have listeners throughout every stage of their career. But maybe you know someone that you're directing to the dental profession. Hey, have them take a look at Midwestern. I feel like it is just an amazing dental school, does an incredible job of preparing our student dentists for life after dental school. And Kiera, you were a part of that for so long, and I get to be a part of that now. And Dr. Smith is, is our fearless leader. But if you know mm-hmm. someone that is considering dental school, have them take a look at Midwestern.
Most definitely. And as the recruiting company that we own, I have doctors all the time that say, I don't want to hire a new grad. I don't think a new grad's a great idea, Kiera. And I say, meet my Midwestern students. I think I can change your mind. And all of them are like jaw to the floor. They are shocked at what Midwestern produces as a school. And I could not echo that loud enough, that I believe in Midwestern so much. They're a phenomenal school.
Can we tease our listeners with your own experience with a 2015 grad? For Midwestern. Would you mind sharing what you did with her in, I think I have the year, right? She graduated in 2015. Is that correct?
I've got a couple of them that I just placed. So we've got a few of them.
But I was thinking of your partner in Colorado.
In Colorado, yes. that is a good tease. I did partner with a student right out of Midwestern, and we took our practice, brand new out of school grad. We felt like we were playing house, and we produced our practice that we bought was $500,000. We had about $2.5 million worth of debt sitting on us. So we were people that say you can't get a loan right out of school. I disagree, because there are definitely ways if you hustle and you work it. We got denied by 10 banks and we were able to get a loan.
You only need one to say yes.
Exactly. And we took a $500,000 practice to $2.4 million in 9 months, and we bought our second practice. And that was, she would always say, I attribute this to Midwestern. Midwestern was, you know, students go off and do residencies, but she felt like, obviously, look at our numbers. She had a mini residency in dental school. I mean, we were placing implants. She had done over 500 cases of CAD/CAM before she graduated, and I'm not exaggerating that number. She did so many. Molar endo was no problem. We could do any molar endo. Extractions, she did all the extractions. Invisalign certified. And that's what all the Midwestern grads come out with. They can place implants. They can do extractions. They come out Invisalign certified. They can all do molar endo. They all come out with wave ones. Like, let's just keep going with how magical they are. Mm-hmm. But really, we were able to do that. And it's from Midwestern. Midwestern is an amazing, amazing school. But not just that. I feel like the culture and the dentists that they produce are people that you want to be friends with, you want to hang out with. They are good to the patients that they serve in the community.
Yeah, we really teach the humanistic approach, and it goes back to a fundamental. And I learned this first from Dr. Pankey, Dr. L.D. Pankey, but he used to start every one of his lectures with a slide. And the slide said, just in very simple terms, always remember that there's a person attached to those teeth. And that may sound very self-evident. Well, of course there is. But if you keep that at the center, at the core of everything you do, then you'll be a hero in the eyes and mind of your patients. And we instill that, you know, in every step of the way. That's what I teach. I teach that stuff. But definitely, it's always helping them understand that there's a person attached to those teeth. So we know.
And Gary, I have to share a funny story about that from a Midwestern student, because you said it sounds so natural that they would remember that there's a human attached to those teeth. But, you know, for those of you who dentists going back to dental school, when, you know, your first and second year, you work on Dexter, which is it's a fake mannequin that you work on.
The best patient ever.
Exactly. Everybody loves their Dexter. But the way you get Dexter to turn his head is you grab the ears and you turn the head to get it to move, right? There was, I'm not kidding.
I know where you're going with this.
There was a student when they crossed the street, and in their third year at Midwestern, they work on real patients and real people. And the student, I'm not kidding, they grabbed the ears of a live human being to turn the head because it had just been natural. And so, no, they do forget that there's that there's a human attached to those teeth. Is such a good point to draw on tonight.
Absolutely. Well, hey, share with our listeners what's kind of coming down the pike with your webinar.
Definitely. Thank you. So shout out to the office managers. What we wanted to do when I worked at Midwestern, the culture of the school was we want to give resources and supplies and anything we possibly can to these students to make sure they're successful. Well, I am not a dentist, and I started my consulting company because I realized I had so many opportunities that I could just share knowledge with dentists and be able to help them grow within their own realm. And that's why I developed the consulting company. And now, after going out and meeting with so many office managers, I realized that there is a need and a place the office managers for them to go to be able to ask these questions. Like the dental students, I tell them, call me, ask me those questions. Like, what is AR? What's a P&L? I have no clue what these things mean, but I don't want to look ridiculous asking, you know, a potential broker these questions. And same thing with the office managers. I want to create a platform and an area where office managers can come, where it's a community. So it's a community-driven model where office managers can come. We're going to be having a webinar in December. We'll have the link in the show notes so you can sign up. So doctors, if you want your office managers to come to this, I want to create a community where office managers actually get the training. We offer a lot of value bombs, but actual specifics. It's not the, I don't want to offer fluff. I want to offer the knit and grit to our office managers. And I also want to create a community for them because, you know, dentists don't always know what an office manager needs to know. So why not send them to these webinars, to this community I want to create? You don't need to fly them somewhere. I want it to be a very easy way for them to get the information and to have a resource. And I want you to think, you know, oh my gosh, I can reach out to Kiera and I'll interact with our office managers and we'll create a community where we all are gleaning off of each other and making each other better. So instead of being divided in our own individual islands, we actually come together and then we're able to be more efficient, more effective. Some offices don't want to pay for consulting. They don't want to have a coach come in. And I really wanted to provide a way for you to get help for your office managers and to have a resource, because a lot of my office managers didn't know where to go to get the help that we now want to offer. So we're going to do the webinar, we're going to have a community, and we're going to do training. And so that's what I really want to offer to the doctors that are listening, to the office managers, of a place to come to have a community. And so space is limited. We'll be doing it in December, and I'm really excited. We're pulling people. So if you even want to jump in and send over a few things that you would love to learn about on this webinar, we're pulling our audience to make sure that the things we deliver are the things that you really, really need. And it's going to be me and a couple other consultants. All of us have great backgrounds, and that will be who we're doing the webinar for.
Well, I love what you're doing here, Kiera. And I'm going to put the link to the webinar in the show notes. So again, the show notes can be found at TACAS, TAKACS, learningcenter.com. And you'll find it in the show notes. One click will take you to the webinar. I'm going to publish this one in time for our listeners to be able to tune into your webinar. And if you are listening to this afterwards, I suspect that there'll be a replay opportunity. So we'll make sure that we get the webinar in their hands. But Kiera, thanks for all that you're doing. And I want to give one more shout out to Dental Placement Pros. You know, my first interview with you, we talked a lot about the challenge of finding your dream team, finding your what we have playfully called the unicorn, right?
Absolutely. We're actually going to do a unicorn shoot in Tonga. So anyone who wants to see it,
you'll see it. So Dental Placement Pros is what I like to think of as an executive search firm for dentistry. And Kiera and her team serve both sides. It's an appropriate place to go if you're looking for the ideal office. Perhaps you're a dentist. Maybe you're a hygienist. You're a team member and you're looking for the ideal office. Dental Placement Pros can help you do that. And on the other side, if we're looking for the perfect team member, Dental Placement Pros, and that could be an associate doctor, that could be a hygienist, that could be an office manager, but Dental Placement Pros can help you find the perfect team as well. So I'll put a link in the show notes to Dental Placement Pros. Doctors, every one of you need to put that in your contacts. You may not have a need right now, but sometime, and I'm going to say probably fairly soon, you will have a need for Dental Placement Pros, and there is simply no better resource to help you find your ideal team member, the Dental Placement Pros. I just want to brag on you for just a minute, Kiera, because you guys do such an amazing job.
Thank you. We try. My goal is to only work with the best offices and place the best people. So we really do work with the best of the best. And I really appreciate that because I keep ourselves to a high level and a high standard. So thank you.
You do it brilliantly. So Kiera, let me close by simply saying thank you. Thanks for all that you do. Thanks for taking 2 weeks out of your extremely busy life to go down to Tonga and help people that simply would not receive care any other way. It's such a wonderful example of why I think our profession is so amazing. I get to go next year. Teresa and I get to go next year, and we'll be toiling away for a couple weeks and then get to spend a week in Fiji. So thanks for all that you do, Kiera. I sure appreciate everything you do.
Thank you, Gary. It was great. And I appreciate all that you do as well. So thank you.
You bet. And hey, I want to take a minute and thank our listeners. We love what we do here at the Thriving Dentist Show, but we try never to forget that we couldn't do it if it wasn't for you. We now have listeners in 157 countries. If you happen to know someone in the other 38 countries, according to the United Nations, there's 195 countries. My goal is to be the first dental podcast that has a listener in all 195 countries. If you happen to know someone in some of the more obscure countries, tell them about the Thriving Burning Dentist Show, so we can add another country to the list. There's three things you can do to support our work. Number one, you can tell a colleague about the Thriving Dentist Show. Many, many dentists have never heard the word podcast. Hey, enlighten them about the world of podcasting and tell them about the Thriving Dentist Show. Tell them about Mark's too, the Dentalpreneur. It's another brilliant podcast. Secondly, you can write us a review. Jump on iTunes and write us a review. That helps us in the same way that a Google review works for your practice. The third thing you can do is you can hit the subscribe button. You can do that on iTunes. You can do that on Google Play or whatever your podcast directory of choice is. Hit the subscribe button. That means every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll automatically be uploaded to your listening device. On that note, let me simply say thank you and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.